really glad, from the Dummerston Conservation Commission and Bonnie Vale Environmental Education Center. This is the third in our series of four Windham County past, present, and future. And the chair of the Dummerston Conservation Commission, Pattie, is with Bonnie Vale Environmental Education Center. I have to tell you a secret about Pattie. Her kindergarten teacher is here.
Where?
I'm very nervous about this. Especially since I'm drawing on the board and she can see my art has not progressed a great deal since kindergarten.
Well, I have to say this, when I had a parent conference with your parents, I said, even in kindergarten, when you were 6 years old, or maybe even five, I said, you have a very outstanding drawing.
Now teachers really, really are. Oh my goodness, so this is my mother.
Telling stories about people.
And she can also tell you how crazy I have been about animals since I was old enough to care about anything. And so my task today is to continue the story that Roger Haydock started 2 weeks ago, looking at the past, present, and future of the rocks around here. And Tom Wessels talked about trees and forests last week. So today, I'm assigned with wildlife, and I have chosen to focus on mammals because most of my best friends are mammals. Almost all of my best friends. There are a few birds in there. And I was originally going to make it a little bit easier for myself by just going back as far as the Pleistocene, Holocene, all of those great big megafauna that we're more or less familiar with. However, inspired by Roger, I've decided to give you just a little bit more context and go way back 65 million years, just to give you a sense of the scope and grandeur of mammals on this planet. So way back here, 65 million years ago, we all know what happened, right? There was this great big fireball from the sky. Bye-bye, dinosaurs. So, meanwhile, underneath the toes of this dinosaur, we see a little mammal. And these mammals, it's believed, survived by doing the things that mammals are really good at, which is hibernating, going into torpor, hiding underground, laying low for a great deal of time. And this ushered in the Cenozoic, which I like to call the Great Age of Mammals. It could as easily be called Great Age of Insects or Flowering Plants, but we're going to call it Mammals. So starting 65 million years ago, mammals just took off. There's this whole vast, almost empty planet now. All of these niches for them to exploit. And one of the first climate events that changes is here between the Paleocene and Eocene 57 million years ago. It becomes very warm and tropical. And well, lots of plants like that sort of thing, and all kinds of great mammalian evolution happens. Mostly small things. We get canids and horses and primates emerging. Then in the Oligocene, I got to refer to my notes here, things cool down, and it's at this point that an undersea shelf connecting Antarctica and Australia disappears, and a circum-Antarctic current sets up, and this initiates seasons and drastic cooling on the planet. And during this period, grasses evolve. Squirrels, those of you that know me know I love squirrels. Squirrels and nut trees begin to co-evolve. Well, some of the other highlights. Flowering trees and plants take off. Dogs, cats and pigs. This is, we're talking mostly about North America here, and so there aren't pigs, but there are peccaries, and the peccaries actually appear here in the Miocene. I'm going to draw a peccary, ready? This is actually, I was starting to draw a rhino, because rhinos actually were a big taxa here in North America during the Miocene. So that's a... They actually had this great rhino type thing with a kind of funny mustache on the top of its nose.
Can you turn up the volume a little bit?
Okay. I don't know. I'll try and holler. Okay. Okay, I'll turn around and holler. So the other thing that we had here in North America were camels that really diversified into all kinds of things. We had camels with really long necks like giraffes. I'm not sure we really had camels with humps, but the Miocene is what's called the golden age of mammals, and mammals just proliferated and became gigantic. And in the Miocene, another wonderful thing happened. Grasses developed. And we're going to talk more about grasses when we get to the Pleistocene. But just know that during this warmer, drier spell following the Oligocene cooling, we had this tremendous proliferation of large mammals in North America. Which brings us up to the Pliocene and the beginning of the Pliocene, which is, as we all know, the Pleistocene. Can you hear me back there? Sometimes.
Yes. I can, but yes. they're not able to. Sorry.
So to review, we have 65 million years of mammals really playing a dominant role on this planet. We have a warming period 57 million years ago. Becomes tropical for a while. We have lots of small things beginning to evolve and diversify. And really so many niches filled by all of these mammals. It's really a complex and well-developed fauna. Oh, here, I should say right about here, the transition between the Oligocene and the Eocene, there were a couple of small asteroids that also contributed to cooling. So they're flying in from this side of the planet. They actually landed, we believe, in the Chesapeake Bay. And that caused a minor extinction event, and then all of these other things began evolving again. So now we are up to really very recent history when we commence the official show right here. During this time of 2.3 million years, sort of the rule for planet Earth has been cold and ice. And here in North America, there have been four major glacial advances and retreats. And the interglacials were warmer and relatively short. So we're going to start focusing on the time here in Windham County since the last glacier departed. So about... I don't have an exact date for when this particular spot was ice-free, but we'll say around 11,000 years ago. And if you were looking out the window, let's just pretend this is the window. We might have seen something very much like this. You can see those are the mountains in New Hampshire behind us, and just down below those mammoths is Glacial Lake Hitchcock. And the one thing that's wrong with this picture is by this time in Windham County, there were no rhinoceroses. This was actually Spain. But there were woolly mammoths and lions and caribou and horses. And I'm just going to give you a little photo tour of some of the more spectacular members of this megafaunal community. This is the short-faced bear. You would not want to mess with this guy. As near as anyone can tell, and it's really hard to put together the lifestyles of these animals, it probably was an opportunistic omnivore, much like our present-day bears, but obviously very big. Everyone knows this guy, right? Our friend Smilodon, the saber-toothed cat. These guys were rather gigantic. Let me just see if I can open my notes here and tell you how big Smilodon. Anyway, they were big. I don't have the number here. I'm not gonna risk it. 2,000 pounds at the largest sticks in my head, but that could be wrong. These guys were smaller. The biggest American lions we had were about 450 pounds, so a bit bigger than a very large black bear. And the stag moose, look at this magnificent thing. Look at those crazy, crazy antlers. About the size of our moose today, but with a head of a deer, so a stag moose. Oh, when I was in my early 20s, I traveled in Peru and adopted a baby two-toed sloth. I have a great fondness in my heart for sloths. This is one of the many types of giant sloths that were part of the Pleistocene megafauna here in Windham County, we think, although no giant sloth bones have been recovered in Windham County. It's a little bit tricky to piece it all together exactly. These guys had obviously massive claws, which they could use to defend themselves against short-faced bears and lions and saber-toothed cats, but they must also have been adapted for digging. There were so many of these things. They had many different lifestyles. Some of them were, in fact, aquatic, marine giant sloths, so we didn't have marine environment here. I doubt there were any swimming in Glacial Lake Hitchcock. But it's just amazing to imagine the diversity of giant animals that survived here. Of course, we had giant beavers. Did you know we had giant beavers?
No.
Yes, well, these beavers were about black bear size, so 300, 400-pound beavers. And we're not sure that these beavers had flat tails like our current beavers. They probably weren't as wonderful at engineering, although there is some evidence that they created lodges using sticks, not necessarily dams. This guy, the mastodon, was more of a woody plant browser, a forest elephant. And then we have the woolly mammoths. And I really had no idea until I started to delve into this, just how important a role woolly mammoths played in shaping the world. So once upon a time, the largest biome, and this would have been during the Pleistocene, and presumably other, well, a slightly different biome during the Miocene, was a grassland, and an arid steppe grassland. And this huge grassland was actually created and maintained by the many grazers and herbivores that thundered over it. In much the same way that our great prairies were created and maintained by the bison herds that once existed there. So how does this work? Grasses are amazing plants. They have most of their, they co-evolved, and this is something that Tom emphasized last week, how species co-evolved to create these systems that function well together and lead toward ever greater cooperation. And grasses and grazers evolved in such a way that they maintain each other. Without grazers, the grasses would be outcompeted by a great variety of other plants, woody plants and other forbs. But because the grasses keep their growing parts under the soil, they're protected from the grazing, and every time a grazer comes by and eats the grass, it's stimulated to produce more growth. And of course, this is what the grazers contribute. imagine this cold, arid environment. Things decompose very slowly. If these grasses want some nutrients, the best way to get them is to, by gosh, run their leaves right through a great big digestive system, and it transforms them into readily available nutrients. So we have mammoths constantly fertilizing the grasses of the mammoth steppe, and that is a mammoth poop there. So it's a great cycle. We were talking a bit about grasses, and they have, unlike other plants, to protect themselves from grazers, they don't bother with thorns and woodiness. They have a little bit of silica in their leaves, and as part of the co-evolutionary dance, the grazers have in turn developed high crowns on their teeth to take to accommodate the silica. And what the grasses do is their root systems really hold that soil in place. Decomposition happens very rapidly above ground in this ecosystem because of all those grazers, and very slowly below ground where carbon has been accumulating for a long time. This map shows the approximate distribution of this mammoth steppe biome. And here we are, Windham County over here. You can just see all those woolly mammoths moving in when the ice leaves. That little circle up there, incidentally, is the last place on Earth where woolly mammoths existed. It was just 4,000 years ago, and it was an island where humans hadn't reached, off the way north of the coast of Siberia. These crazy scientists in Siberia, I shouldn't call them crazy, they're very interested in and have been studying this mammoth steppe for a long time and have found it to be an extremely productive biome. They estimate that this biome supports 10.5 tons of herbivores per square kilometer. So by counting bones in particular areas where they can see the different bones in different strata due to collapsing banks and such, they estimate 2 bison, 7.5 horses, 15 reindeer, a quarter of a woolly mammoth, and other herbivores per square kilometer would have been the density. And they estimate that that is one of the less productive parts of this mammoth steppe biome. They think that over in parts of North America could have been twice as high. So 20 tons of herbivores per square kilometer were being sustained by this mix of grass and forbs and willow shrubs. Oh yes, well, our history has been one of mammals moving and intermixing as land forms connect and disconnect, and of course, there's usually a little period of getting used to each other and things stabilize, and this represents the arrival in North America and other parts of the world of another mammal that had a significant impact on the fauna of North America, and that, I think there are some of them sitting in this room today, where, yes, we are talking about Homo sapiens who arrived in North America and around here 12,000 to 11,000 years ago. This picture makes me so sad. This is the giant beaver. And so these Clovis hunters with their giant spear points not only encountered lots of big, tasty animals, but this picture might more accurately look something like this, because the animals were not used to people. They were a naive fauna and probably weren't particularly afraid of people for a while, which made them very easy to kill. This is my friend Dewberry the beaver showing. I don't think the giant beavers would have been that interested in walking up to the early hunters, but I don't know as they would have been particularly inclined to run away either.
They didn't have apples, did they?
I could have taught those hunters a thing or two. Oh, dear. So another thing that may have contributed to people's ability to wipe out the megafauna of North America was the defrosting that happened after the glaciers melted and the temperatures were really warm around here. As the permafrost begins to melt, you no longer have this great flat plain where the mammoths can see you coming. The permafrost breaks up in ways that create these thermokarst lakes and canyons and lots of places for hunters to hide and lots of these cliffs that you can drive mammoths over, and it becomes very possible to kill a lot of animals all at once. It doesn't take very far for a giant mammoth to fall to break its legs. And in Siberia, where they've been doing all this research, they have uncovered a number of these mass mammoth kill sites where there are, you know, bones of dozens of mammoths at the all piled up together with signs that humans had been carving them up. So,
can they tell if the in those giant, in those large kill sites, did humans recover for themselves most of the meat of those, or were a lot of those mammoths killed and not even used by the humans?
Yeah, there was no way they could have begun to use all of the resources there.
That's what one would think.
Yeah.
But they can't, can they definitively show that?
No, I don't think so. Yeah, all those soft tissues just disappear. So this is a wonderful graphic showing the Pleistocene megafauna of Mexico, and a lot of these were species that were also seen here. And so within a relatively short time, and it's not known exactly how long it took, and it's also hypothesized that there may have been a meteor involved, but something like 32 of the 47 genera of mammals in North America were wiped out, and we can clearly see that we no longer have giant ground sloths or woolly mammoths. Just an interesting point is that some of the giant ground sloths did persist on the island of Cuba until, I think it was somewhere between 5 and 7,000 years ago when the first people finally arrived there, and then that was it for the giant ground sloths. So when you don't have grazers compacting the soil, when you don't have grazers controlling the woody plants, when you don't have grazers really fostering the grass, this is what that area looks like now. It's tundra with mostly woody heathy plants and lichens and moss, and it's a much less productive, in terms of herbivores and mammals, a much less productive zone, and probably in terms of photosynthetic capacity also. Just a little bit of an aside, these Russians that I have sometimes referred to as crazy, the reason I refer to them as crazy is they have set aside a part of Siberia now that they're calling Pleistocene Park, and they're increasing the density of grazers there to see if that will cause a grassland to reestablish. And in fact, it has. And the potential, the reason we should be interested in that is because trampling those soils and turning mosses and wet things into grass also tends to really cool the soil and may prevent the permafrost from melting. And we all know that we do not want permafrost to melt because there's a lot of methane in there, which will just vastly increase climate change. It also increases the planet's reflectivity, so that will also increase the cooling. So maybe what we want to do is turn all of our tundra areas back into grasslands by introducing lots of grazers. I don't know. We've done so much meddling in our brief history on this planet that I'm not going to endorse that, but it's being looked at in Russia. So, while all of these great giant things were thundering around the mammoth steppe outside of our windows here 12,000 years ago, there was a supporting cast of animals that will look very familiar to you. Most of the animals that we have around us today were there then, and these are the ones that have persisted. We have, well, you will soon make the acquaintance of the entire lot of them when we get to the present. So humans must have gone through a process of naturalization over the past 10,000 years, because after the loss of all of those giant mammals, we have had no further mammalian extinctions. Those early hunters became the woodland peoples, and the eventually became more settled agrarians, the Algonquins, the Abenaki. And they seem to live in harmony with the native fauna for the next 10,000 years. Until the arrival of our friends from Europe. And in particular, this is Samuel de Champlain arriving. Let's see. I like this map because I think that's a porcupine. And you cannot read this, but I think that's Lake Champlain. Or no, maybe that's Lake Champlain. Somewhere on there is Lake Champlain. And when Samuel sailed down Lake Champlain, he encountered Native Americans who were all ready to communicate with him and say, hey, how many beavers do you want? They had already been exposed to fur traders at that point and knew what Europeans could offer them in exchange. And instantly, from this place of being naturalized and living in harmony with the fauna, the forests of North America, they became exploiters again. But we're not going to blame the North Americans, because no, the real reason that the beavers were so coveted was because the Europeans loved these hats. These hats are felt hats made with a nice waterproof under fur of beavers. And the beavers of North America were wiped out so dandies could wear their beaver hats in Europe. And so the voyagers traveled all across Canada, killing every single beaver, and it happened in Vermont, too. There were essentially no beavers in Vermont by the 1800s. And the beavers, of course, we'll talk a little bit more about what beavers do, but they had also created in these beaver flowages, all the silt builds up and creates great soil for agriculture. The trappers also eliminated these gorgeous creatures. Look at that fur. These were not turned into hats, no. Fishers had the most valuable pelts of any animal in Windham County, and they were soon trapped out. And the same with lynx. Oh my gosh, look at those beautiful things. Turned into fur coats. Can you imagine anyone more worthy of a lynx coat than this beast right here? There was also a great deal of market hunting. The large mammals of Vermont were turned into meat for the markets in the south, and here we have elk. We had an eastern elk species that is now extinct, except some of them were shipped, we believe, to New Zealand, where they have since interbred with western elk, and they don't belong in New Zealand anyway. Anyway, so there, once upon a time we had elk here, and of course the noble moose, also hunted, and white-tailed deer were actually very rare. Yes. And of course, once the land started to be cleared, we heard about this from Tom Wessels last week, for the Great Merino Sheep, this advertisement for Bridport, Vermont, dealer in Spanish Merino Sheep. Vermont's landscape changed radically, such that woodland creatures that remained had a very hard time surviving. This is Dummerston. And the wolves that persisted were absolutely persecuted. There were wolf hunting parties, and I think the last wolf was shot in as recently as 1920, but there are no wolves now in Vermont, and catamounts disappeared even earlier. Largest catamount on record was also the last one that was killed in something like 1861 and weighed 182 pounds. So these are big cats. And a little quote here from our friend Henry David Thoreau: when I consider that the nobler animals have been exterminated here, the cougar, panther, lynx, wolverine, wolf, bear, moose, deer, and the beaver, turkey, etc., etc. That's quite a list of species that had disappeared from his part of New England. I cannot but feel as if I live in a tamed and, as it were, emasculated country. Is it not a maimed and imperfect nature I am conversant with? Yes. Does anyone know who this is?
Passenger pigeon.
Which one?
The last one.
Martha. Yes. This is Martha, who died in the Cincinnati Zoo, I think it was 1914. And I diverge here to birds just because Martha sort of represents a turning point, maybe, in the history of European humans in North America. So once upon a time, passenger pigeons were the most numerous bird on the planet. Their population was something like 3 to 5 billion, and they were such social birds that this 3 to 5 billion may have been divided into just a few flocks that moved up and down the east and central parts of North America, very dependent on fruits and nut trees, and of course then we had the great forests of chestnuts, and when these birds flew over, it was supposed to have darkened the sky for hours and hours. It must have been just an unbelievable phenomenon. And we all know that now they are completely gone. They were, because they exist in these huge flocks, it was very easy to hunt them, and the markets were just full of pigeons, and the baby pigeons, squab, were nice, fat, strange-looking little, completely helpless things that were very easy to harvest. Because imagine these giant flocks all nesting in the same places. People could just go in there with clubs and essentially wipe out the entire brood. So once they had disappeared, this Republican Congressman John Lacey passed a bill called the Lacey Act, and this is what he said in defense of this legislation: the wild pigeon, formerly in flocks of millions, has disappeared entirely from the face of the earth. We have given an awful exhibition of slaughter and destruction which may serve as a warning to all mankind. Let us now give an example of wise conservation of what remains of the gifts of nature. So, maybe the beginning of a turning point. Following the Lacey Act, we started to see additional protection for wildlife. There was the Migratory Bird Act a couple of years later, which also protected nests and feathers and eggs. And Aldo Leopold is who I always go to for poetry and solace on the natural world. And in 1947, he wrote, "Men still live who in their youth remember pigeons. Trees still live who in their youth were shaken by a living wind. But a few decades hence, only the oldest oaks will remember, and at long last, only the hills will know." And I'm afraid that's probably where we are today. Well, maybe there are a few oaks. There probably are a few oaks. Which brings us to the present. All right, so the present. This is my friend Burdock, the baby porcupine. So we have some indication that people, especially people here in Windham County, are thinking about becoming naturalized, or thinking about what it means to become naturalized, which is you play well with others. And I'm just going to give you an introduction to the mammals that live here with us now. And remember that these individuals are all part of an integrated system of living things. We're going to start with, strangely enough, with one of the newer arrivals, just because this is also our most primitive creature. First, a possum appeared in Vermont, waddled up one of the roads following a trail of snack foods from parts south. Opossums are, of course, our only marsupial in Vermont. Oh, look at this poor mama. They can have up to 13 babies, and they raise them in a pouch. I know, that's a very disturbing image, isn't it? Maybe this next one you'll like a little bit better. Once they outgrow the pouch, they ride around on mama's back. Now, opossums have a number of special features, given their how distantly related they are to our other mammals of Windham County. They don't tend to be susceptible to rabies. Their body temperature is a little too cold. They're immune to rattlesnake venom. They have an opposable thumb on their rear paw. They have prehensile tail. Oh, I know possums very well because I've had the great privilege of being a mother possum myself many times. And the pouch stage is easier. Let me just tell you, the pouch stage is a little easier. These guys are riding around in the porta possum. I carry with me everywhere. It's easier if you're a human, not if you're a possum. So these guys are great carrion eaters and provide food for all kinds of other bigger creatures, and it astonishes me that they manage to survive here at all. And in fact, they really only survive here by the good graces of humans, and don't tend to live in the remote forest, but only near human inhabitations. They're not well adapted for our winters.
So where do they live in the winter?
They live under your house. They do tend to live near where people are and find shelter in and around human habitation, and are very vulnerable if they're out in the woods somewhere away from people. I've tracked some of my possum children and seen how they make it through the winter in places that don't really involve human shelter, and they can do it, but studies have shown that they really depend on human infrastructure to survive in Windham County. So now we've got all these wonderful little insectivores, two groups, and I point these out because a lot of people see small animals and say, oh, that's a mouse. But a lot of our small animals are moles and shrews, and especially shrews. And I want you to look at that skull and all those sharp pointy teeth up there. These are not rodents. These are little fish, not vicious, no. They're hungry little insect eaters, and they've got those teeth to crunch things up. They're also our smallest animals. So in this one genus, we have these three shrews that are, you know, they live low to the ground, even subterranean a lot of the time, just voraciously eating. Their hearts beat 20 times a second. It's kind of a maximum, maybe not their normal heart rate, but just extremely energetic little beasts. A couple more. The northern water shrew I love. I managed to see one once, but they swim underwater a lot and eat macroinvertebrates under the rocks, and they have this gift. These are the Jesus Christ shrews. They can walk on the water. They have got these little furry bristles on the bottom of their feet that allow them to trap air bubbles, which adds to their natural buoyancy. This is our most common shrew, the short-tailed shrew. And indulge me here. A lot of people just don't get to see what these critters are like when they're animated.
They usually run away from you, but this one here, he was...
So this person found this shrew in their backyard and I gave him some cheese. Now their friend because they gave it some cheese.
And right after I gave him some cheese,
but
he
just
was real friendly with
me and let
me pick him
up. And we're going to get a little close-up of this, the face.
You
can see that they're really adapted
really
to underground
eyes.
Life because they've got this short fur, so it goes, they can go forward and backward in their underground tunnels.
It's really cute,
and
isn't
their
it?
Eyes have become extremely tiny. And note the tiny front feet as well as tiny back feet. These are, you wouldn't think they'd be great diggers,
really
but
on
once I put a little pile
knowledge.
Of sunflower seeds
yeah,
next to me
to
in the woods,
oh, he's so
and a
cute.
Shrew came up out of a hole and ran over the sunflower
see
seeds to get a seed.
See the eye? Look a smaller
and then
eyes
it disappeared, and I could hear this
critter.
Noise traveling
like,
through the
up.
Ground. I could hear it chewing
the old
tree
saying,
roots,
on,
and the darn thing
stomach.
Popped up right underneath
right,
the pile
not,
of sunflowers and started taking them from
yeah,
there. So we could just keep going here, but no, we're going to go back. So the mole, see those great big digging paws? This is what one of the things that differentiates the shrews from the moles. And the star-nosed mole is one of my absolute favorite beasts. And they live in soft soils so that they do not damage their very special noses. And I've got one of these for you, too, with these guys. Just watch these. Star-nosed shrew moles are the most amazingly sensitive mammalian appendages. They have the most sensitive sense of touch of any other mammal. With those amazing noses of theirs. Come back with your nose. And like the shrews, you can see they've got that soft, short fur. Little tiny hind feet by comparison to those large digging shovels for front feet. Now bats. We've got a number of bats in Vermont. These three species are our beautiful tree bats. And these are forest bats. These are bats that migrate. These are not bats that you're going to find in dense colonies in your attic. Very seldom seen, but really beautiful coats. Look at this bright orange-red bat and the hoary bat. Look at that. The colors on the face of that creature. And the silver-haired bat has got this silver tip on those black hairs, and these are, of course, great insect eaters. And just think of how impressive it is to be a mammal when we have these fellow mammals that can actually fly. Isn't that cool? They are just astonishing creatures. These guys migrate south in the winter. They are not being impacted by white nose syndrome yet, and probably never will be because they don't congregate in the cold places where that fungus thrives. Here are our cave bats. These are the bats that are around here year-round, but of course hibernating in caves in the winter. Little brown bat, big brown bat, tri-colored bat, formerly known as the Eastern Pipistrelle. If you're wondering what became of the Eastern Pipistrelle, it turned into this. The long-eared bat. The pipistrelle and long-eared are less common. The little brown bat was once the most common bat in Windham County. Oh my gosh, the nights I've had with just great flocks, I don't know, what do you call a flock of bats? Great flutters of bats all around. Just magical. And their population is a tenth of what it was before white nose syndrome just wiped them out at their caves. Big brown bats have not been as badly impacted. In fact, their population seems to be holding steady, and it's believed that it's because they often overwinter in other places. So we do still have big brown bats, and any bats you see flying around your houses now are likely to be these big brown bats. Tricolored bats, never as numerous as little brown, and long-eared bats, also never as numerous, are also suffering from white nose syndrome. Yeah. Oh, is it? Oh, gosh.
It's a lovely background.
Let's see. Let me just turn these right off. There we go. Okay. So we have two members of the rabbit and hare group here in Windham County. Here in Dummerston, it's probably just eastern cottontails, but the eastern cottontails are doing much better than they were recently, so you may start to see little bunny tracks around here more often. Up where I live in Marlboro, we have snowshoe hare. Cottontails have little naked babies in their little nest. They grow very quickly. They reproduce very rapidly. Snowshoe hares have fully furred babies that are ready to hop pretty much the moment that they're born. So that's one of the differences between cottontails and hares. These snowshoe hares are just amazing animals. They can leap 12 feet in a single bound and are really adapted for winter. Thus the snowshoes, right? Some of you may have heard of New England cottontails, which we once had here. They moved into Vermont relatively recently and were more southern New England phenomenon, but were displaced when the eastern cottontail, which is apparently more fun to hunt, was introduced up here. The New England cottontail is now an endangered species, very endangered, and no longer found in Vermont, just in a few little pockets elsewhere in New England, very dependent on brushy habitat that doesn't really exist as much anymore. So we've got these isolated populations are struggling. My favorite group of animals. I love rodents, only because I know a lot of rodents very well. Now, I mean that in the nicest way. So compare these teeth to the teeth of those little insectivores, and you can see that mice and shrews are very different animals. What makes a rodent are these chisel teeth. They've got this very hard iron enamel on the outer surface, and it's a softer tooth behind that, so they're self-sharpening all the time and creating these very sharp files, and we know what they can do with those. Yes, this rodents are probably the most successful group of mammals on the planet. There are both more species of rodents than any other mammal group by a lot, and more individual rodents, as you might have guessed, by a lot. And in this rodent group here in Windham County, we have squirrels, mice, voles, lemmings, muskrat, beaver, and porcupine, all rodents. This is the squirrel group, and I'm a wildlife rehabilitator, so I get to spend a lot of time with squirrels in certain parts of the year. We have two ground squirrels. Did you know that chipmunks and woodchucks are squirrels? Yes, ground squirrels. And our tree squirrels are red squirrel, gray squirrel, and we have two flying squirrels. Northern and southern overlap their ranges here. And remember, these are the guys that co-evolved with the nut trees a long, long time ago here in Windham County. Ah, chipmunks. I've had the great fortune to raise baby chipmunks and learn quite a lot from these little guys. They're just extremely bold little creatures when they're not sleeping. They charge around with their eyes shut, And if you think about where they grow up, this makes sense. I mean, even when other mammals really would have had their eyes open, their eyes remain shut. I put one in a box one day. I have this, the fed box and the need to be fed box, and I had put one chipmunk with its eyes still closed in the fed box and answered the telephone. It was there by itself for a long time and got nervous, and when I looked back in the box, its eyes were open, which makes me think that it just suddenly needed more sensory information to figure out where everybody else was, so opened its eyes. And just very bold, they decided on their own that they would move in with the squirrels, and these chipmunks grew up with squirrels. Whoops, go this way.
Before you leave the chipmunks, where are they in the winter? I never see them.
Oh, winter. Excellent question. The chipmunks are really hibernators, so they're underground in their burrows, and that's why they've got those gigantic cheek pouches. They're busy scurrying down there, filling their larders. And we know this particular animal here, the woodchuck, is also a hibernator down in its burrow. And what it does, it gets very fat. You can see that they're good at getting very fat. So it's just living off its fat, but the chipmunk has stored a lot of seeds, if it's lucky, in its pantry underground, and it wakes up a lot more often. And it's believed that this ability to wake up quickly may help it, because there's a certain predator that is very, very good at getting into chipmunk burrows and eating those little guys, and if they're able to wake up like that and run, they've got half a chance. Myself, I kind of hope that they sleep through the whole experience. That sounds more pleasant to me, but we'll get to their predator in a moment. Ah, woodchucks. They obviously are a species that does even better when there are grasslands, but you'll often find their burrows out in the woods, especially near grasslands. Oh, gray squirrels. Yeah.
It's a woodchuck and a groundhog the same?
Yes. Woodchucks, groundhogs, whistle pigs. What other names do we have for them? These guys can swim very well. They climb trees, and they make this great whistle noise when they're alarmed. That's the whistle pig. And if you want to encourage them to move away from your garden, a rag soaked in original strength pine sol in their burrow will encourage them to move. Beverly Major, I suggested this to her because one was burrowing into the foundation of her barn, and she said it worked. And call me if you have problems with wildlife. I've got all kinds of great ideas like this.
Is that semi-tame?
Oh, yes. This is apparently her pet woodchuck. I think they're very cute together, those two.
Yeah.
I think it was much more common to keep or try to keep wild animals as pets at a certain time in Vermont's history. Right now it's illegal, and you have to have a special license, as I do, to even take care of them and have them in your custody at all. So I've spent a lot of time with these guys, gray squirrels. They're just amazing arborealists and co-evolved with those oak trees in such a way that they've really helped to expand the range of oak trees. Oh dear, it's not easy work, but somebody's got to do it. It's very difficult to do anything else when you've got adolescent squirrels that need attention. Oh dear. But eventually they grow up, and when they grow up, they let you know that they want to go live in the trees, and that's what they do. And it's terrifying for a mother to watch a child scamper to the top of a tall tree out on those wispy little branches and frolic around for the first time. Absolutely, I've gotten used to it now, but amazing.
Do they bite at all, Penny?
What's that?
Do they bite at all?
Oh, yeah. I was laughing back there, the stories they've heard. They're very playful like kittens, and I'm always scratched and bitten, and And they will definitely bite aggressively also if they have to. And you've seen those sharp chiseled teeth. Yes, Bob?
Well, I only found out a couple of years ago, but oak trees, you see tips of them on the ground, and that's because these guys can't quite reach the acorn without taking the twig.
Yeah.
Is that true?
Yes, it's definitely not a perfect symbiosis from the tree's point of view. Squirrels love to eat buds of trees, especially when they can't get nuts, and also will nip off the ends of twigs, but they have evolved this system that has served them well for a long time, and it will continue to evolve, fingers crossed. Here we have our friend the red squirrel. Red squirrels are really conifer affiliates. They eat cone seeds predominantly when they can, unless there's a failure of the cone crop, and then they will eat buds and things like that. And walnuts.
So if you wanted to keep, we have a lot of gray squirrel, them from eating buds of our young trees that we planted, leave nuts around or something to distract them?
That's the possibility, yeah. Yep. Sunflower seeds will work.
Unsalted peanuts.
And, oh yeah, they love peanuts. These guys are my favorites, flying squirrels. Whenever I get to raise a flying squirrel, I'm just in heaven. Of course, it's not usually a good story for the mother flying squirrel that I'm replacing, but they are nocturnal, as you can tell by looking at their eyes. They're very soft, and... very playful, and once they get to the stage where they're learning to fly, one of their favorite games is leaping from person to person. They, trying to gauge the distance, they'll perch on your shoulder and move back and forth and get up their nerve and finally do a big leap. One of the things, and they're always exploring to find appropriate den cavities. This is the northern flying squirrel. Someone in Putney had 19 of them living in their attic, making a heck of a noise all winter, so they sent them all to me. And these guys especially are fungus specialists and are very good at moving around the spores of those mycorrhizal fungi that Tom Wessels was talking about last week that are so important in maintaining tree health and possibly even tree communication. That doesn't happen without, well, it does happen, but it happens much faster with the help of all of these animals that love to eat those mushrooms, and especially these northern flying squirrels, which are very good at transporting them some distance. Now, those of you who know me at all know that I have a special affection for beavers. I've been studying a family of beavers for the last 9 years. This is my favorite beaver of all, little Dewberry. Beavers are a keystone species, which means that they create the habitat, they create the forest structure that a number of other species depend on for survival. Oh, yes, this is Bunchberry telling me all about it, and Dewberry. So by creating their own habitat, building these great dams, they're also creating many ponds in woodlands, ponds that benefit all kinds of trout and herons and amphibians. And eventually, because beavers are transitory animals, they leave and the ponds become meadows. And they also just create tremendous beauty in our forest environment. It's a break from the tree to come into a meadow.
Well, muskrat and beaver cohabitat?
Yes, there's a wonderful BBC footage of... inside of a beaver lodge, showing a muskrat coming and going from the beaver lodge. It's very funny.
I heard that they don't, the people are not careful with muskrat because muskrats are inclined to build holes in the dams.
Oh, well, that's possible. That's possible. But they do actually share not just ponds, but occasionally lodges. Oh, is that right?
The muskrat art is prolific, but
yeah, it's there are a lot more species that eat muskrats than eat beavers. So now here we are, the things that people think of first when they think of rodents, maybe the mice. We have deer mice and white-footed mice around here. The deer mice are becoming increasingly prolific. The white-footed mice, they're almost indistinguishable. I know of no way to tell them apart by looking, but white mice are more arboreal, and I think higher elevation, more woodland mice. In my experience, they become tame very rapidly if you offer them a handful of sunflower seeds, and I have also learned that they have small cheek pouches, and they'll fill their cheek pouches. You can see on this guy here, those fat cheek pouches. Oh. Yes. Look also at the large eyes and big ears. These are nocturnal mice. We have also jumping mice. So we're up to four species of mice now, meadow jumping mice and woodland jumping mice. And boy, they can jump. If you see something.
Shift to the ears.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. Okay. Now I'm all confused. Oh, I was going to say, jumping across the road in front of you in ways that's not just a hop, 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 but a bound, bound, bound. You've just seen the elusive, very nocturnal woodland jumping mouse. It's been my great privilege to have spent some time with jumping mice. And they also, they're amazing. You bring sunflower seeds out when you're sitting in the woods with beavers, and you can hear these guys boing, boing, hopping through the woods from a great distance. And when they get close, when they're in their high hopping phase, it doesn't seem to be a very deliberate thing. It seems to be very erratic. I think it's a predator escape confusion mechanism, but I've seen them land in the beaver ponds, and they'll land in my lap, and they'll land right in the bag of sunflower seeds and just settle right down and eat them with me sitting right there. It's quite astonishing. The other thing people call mice a lot are these voles. We have a number of different vole species. The red-backed vole is a woodland vole. The meadow vole is the one that lives in any hayfield and meadow with grass thatch. And very extremely prolific. They can have 17 litters in a good year. And they are really anchoring the food chain for the predators of our area. Just amazing. Woodland voles, I have seen less of and know less about. Little short tails there, almost no ears. Bog lemmings are restricted to wet places. You'll see these nests in the spring, very cozy in their shredded grass balls of nest. This is a one of my friends, a red-backed vole. They're more woodland voles. And just watch the dexterity with which they shell and eat those sunflower seeds. Just, I mean, could you do that? No, this is they're great. And we're going to take a little break here at the commencement of my section on my favorite porcupines. So, stand up, stretch, have some coffee.
Okay. Patty, I had a question.
Yes.
Do foxes hibernate?
No. Foxes remain active all winter and... Oh, let me turn this back on. Does that make any difference?
No.
All right, sorry about that. They remain active, but after a big snowstorm like the one we just had, until the snow settles and becomes easier to walk in, they just Well, yeah, they hunker down and don't move and save their energy resources. For any species in a Vermont winter, it's a matter of careful conservation of energy to make it through. But they all have good strategies. That's why they're here. That's how they've managed to survive. Porcupines. Maybe before I forget, I should mention frogs. Edna, who has known me since I was very small, knows that I've always had a thing about frogs also. And I definitely do not want to pay short shrift to all of the other amphibians, reptiles, think of those turtles, that are really such an important part of the wildlife of Windham County. And we'll remind me to talk more about frogs when we get to the future. So I've been spending a lot of time with porcupines the last few years, partly because I met this great porcupine named Fretful, who had an awful lot to show me and teach me in the woods around my house. He was just a very social adult porcupine. And since then, I've raised a few different young porcupines, like Burdock here. And these guys are strictly herbivorous. In the wintertime, they move from their rocky dens to the hemlock trees where they primarily feed, or sometimes the beech trees. This is just a little light break. They're very playful. You know, this, let's see what happens if I unplug this. Yeah, we're not getting any sound through the speaker for some reason. So this is, porcupines are playful creatures. Which is kind of a wonder because they grow up with their stodgy old mothers. Mother porcupines have just one baby. I like to imagine that mothers and babies play like this. And really, you don't want to play with a porcupine barehanded. And it's more because of their teeth, those sharp rodent teeth and the quills. So 30,000 quills, these are very well-armored creatures. And as a result, they're very calm. Mostly very calm, docile, not too afraid of anything. And they are also very free with expressing their opinions about things and are very opinionated. So I was able to follow Burdock out last winter to live with a group of wild porcupines and learned a lot about them also.
I was just wondering how you came up with the name that you do for your friends.
Ah, well, Burdock. Someone helped me with Burdock. He really did look just like a little burr. Often it depends on what plants they like to eat or what plants are blooming in the season when I find them, but I've been running out of names. So this is my friend Fretful, who's demonstrating that porcupines also dig up the fruiting bodies of some of those fungi. These are underground fruiting bodies, so when he eats them, he's then pooping the spores of these mushrooms all around the forest. Good job, Fretful. Oh, well, Fretful is named from Shakespeare. Hamlet has a quote about the fretful porpentine, which I found remarkable, because how much experience could Shakespeare have had with porcupines? They don't have porcupines in England. So, obviously, their reputation had crossed the ocean by that point. Then Fretful is indeed a great way to refer to porcupines.
Well, that brings up the question, but are there any porcupines elsewhere in the world?
Yes, actually, there are porcupines in many parts of the world. There's a great prehensile-tailed porcupine in South America. Then there are African porcupines that are distantly related, the ones with the super long quills. Mm-hmm. Have you seen those? Wandering around the deserts of Africa, very long quills. But this is our only North American porcupine, came up from South America about when the continents finally crossed, or finally touched at the Panama Isthmus, and and there was a great American interchange of South American mammals moving north, North American mammals moving south. So we get porcupines, and they get sloths, actually, from us. And it is just a crazy, crazy mix. Now, muskrats, we were talking about earlier, muskrats are little aquatic creatures with flattened tails, and they play a very important role in our especially large cattail wetlands where they live and build homes out of cattails and mud, very similar to what beavers do. But, you know, if you think of our friends, the Three Little Pigs and the Big Bad Wolf, the beavers make their house out of sticks, and muskrats make their house out of straw. But in the process of building these lodges, they're also creating openings in these cattail swamps that provide really great breeding and feeding areas for wild ducks and other aquatic waterfowl, where they're protected from predators and hunters. And leaving the rodents behind, we're on to the carnivores. There are fewer of them, and they have teeth like this, sharp meat-eating teeth. Ah, so here's our friend the red fox. These guys are busy right now using those gigantic ears to look for mice listen for mice under the snow. They're very good at hearing them and pouncing precisely. And let's see if this works. You may hear this sound. This is the red fox bark. You'll find it all over the internet, labeled fisher cat scream. Fishers don't make noises. They're very quiet creatures. Any animal will scream under duress, but they don't just wander around the landscape making noises like that the way foxes do. Oh, sorry, I don't have any sound for this one. Eastern coyotes arrived in Vermont in 1948 is when the first one showed up here, and moving in to fill the niche vacated when we finally managed to kill the last wolf. These guys are so adaptable, and it's really important to have a large carnivore in our ecosystem to try and keep things in balance, and it's a balance that's trying to reestablish itself after all of the monkeying around we've done. These guys are also a southern animal. They arrived in Vermont in the last couple centuries. The gray fox can climb trees. I see them more and more often. They're just the most dainty, beautiful little creatures, and this is what they sound like. And like the red fox, you'll just hear them anytime. They're crepuscular, nocturnal, so it's more likely to be after dark, but beautiful, beautiful little creatures. And of course, is this everyone's favorite animal, the black bear? I love black bears. We'll talk a little bit more about them as we get to the future. My favorite thing from a couple years ago, and the Bear Center had a live cam in a bear's den in Minnesota or someplace like that. And she had these twin cubs, and I just had it on my desktop all the time, and you could watch what was going on in the bear den. The little cubs make the craziest noises, and they're just so active and adorable. And most surprising was how alert and attentive this hibernating mother bear was the whole time. She was awake a lot and taking care of those cubs. Kind of surprising. And these guys have got extremely sensitive, dexterous front paws that they walk around the world just feeling for things to eat. And they're great to watch. We have got this group of five weasels, all different sizes, members of the Mustelidae family. So the tiniest ones, we'll go through them one at a time, but this gives you some sense of how they've differentiated themselves by size. These ermines, the ones on the top, are little tiny chipmunk eaters. Then we've got the long-tailed weasel, slightly bigger. The mink, which is semi-aquatic and also spends a lot of time hunting on the land. Fishers and river otters are giant, up to 30-pound weasels. So this ermine is the one that I was saying is very good at sneaking down into those chipmunk holes and finding the little sleepy guys. And this little meadow vole that it has nabbed there gives you a sense of how tiny they really are. And just so absolutely energetic all winter long, they have to be active and feeding constantly. And the long-tailed weasel has a tail that is longer than half its body length. If you ever happen to see one, longer than half its body length, shorter for the short-tailed. That's if you don't have reference in your head for the size difference, these guys can and do kill squirrels. The mink spends a lot of time in and along waterways. And the fisher, this big, magnificent, beautiful beast that was reintroduced in Vermont after being extirpated by the trappers, reintroduced partly to bring the population of porcupines back under control. They're the only real effective predator of porcupines, and they're also just very energetic and beautiful. River otters, oh gosh, all right, I'm going to indulge you. River otters, little river otter play here. Oh, look, there's sound. These guys just play their whole little lives, you know, it doesn't matter how old they are. Life is a frolic if you're an otter. This is a mother otter with her almost grown family. And so these guys are really very aquatic, eating fish and crayfish, and they move a lot. You very seldom see an otter in the same place 2 days in a row unless it's got a great source of fish or it's raising its babies.
Can I ask a question about otters and minks?
Yeah.
Am I correct that otters would not be in small streams if we're seeing large weasel tracks and slides,
Yeah, well, it's pretty. Otters will move across country to get from one watershed to another. So if you see a belly slide that's about yay wide, it's a mink. And if you see one that's about yay wide, it's an otter. Yeah, it's really different. Okay, that's enough. That's enough. Okay. So this, that's enough.
Do the fishers make a big difference in the porcupine population? It seems to me that I hardly ever see a porcupine.
Yeah, they did. They made a big difference.
Too much of a difference?
I don't think so. It seems like, again, it's that process of naturalizing initially the fisher population went way up, the porcupine population went way down, but it seems like they're back in balance. So I'm thinking that, I mean, they have this long historical relationship, so I think we're good. This beautiful creature was historically a member of the Windham County fauna. And I wouldn't have brought this slide with me today, except that pine martens have been rediscovered in Glastonbury, just over the county line. There was an attempt to reintroduce them in the Green Mountain National Forest a number of years ago. These are another animal that was trapped out because of their beautiful fur, and because the forests were gone, essentially, when the sheep were here. But they were... People found that a few pine martens have persisted as a result of that reintroduction attempt, so it's possible that they may make their way over the mountain range and into Windham County proper. However, they are really a deep snow-affiliated species, and they don't compete well with fishers. So where there's deep snow, pine martens prevail, and where there isn't deep snow, the fishers do. So it's all going to depend a bit on how snowy our winters are. Oh, these guys used to be considered members of the weasel family. Now they're in a class of their own, the skunks. Skunks, like porcupines, are just extremely docile because they can be. They've got just the fantastic defense. So, you know, you can get quite close to skunks and not worry about it because they're not worried about you unless you're actively aggressing them. And then they can just... Yeah. So don't worry about being near a skunk unless you're trying to catch it. You'll be fine. They're insect eaters predominantly in the summer, digging up all those grubs in your lawn. And so if you've got little tiny divots all over your lawn, it's the skunks, and that's what they're doing. And the grass will grow back in, don't worry. And they also eat fruits and are relatively omnivorous little creatures. And our one kitty, the bobcat, has managed to survive here in Windham County. Once upon a time, we probably had these guys when it was snowier. This is not a bobcat. We'll go back and bobcat's got little ear tufts. This guy, the Canada lynx, has got, they weigh about the same as a bobcat, but they're like bobcats on stilts and snowshoes. Look at the size of those feet. So they're really adapted for snow and eating snowshoe hair. And of course, this guy used to live in Windham County, and should I ask how many of you have seen a catamount? one. So we do have sightings, and chances are that they're just passing through. There may not be enough large hunks of habitat left to sustain them, but possibly. And then last but not least, we have white-tailed deer, which there are probably too many of now. Yeah.
Oh. So about the mountain lion.
Yeah.
That's the same thing, catamount, mountain lion.
Right.
Okay. So they are migrating east.
Yes.
Are they here?
They probably aren't breeding here, but they probably are moving through. And I am not sure our wilderness areas are big enough in Vermont to sustain a breeding population. The jury's still out on that. And then there's also the question of whether or not they'll be tolerated by humans in Vermont. So, but in the meantime, you know, it's possible that you could see one wandering around. They do have to wander far, especially the young males, to try and find a territory. But then once they find a territory, they need to find a female mountain lion, which is, and it's going to take the females a lot longer to get over here.
You think with the deer population, it would be a good spot?
You would think so, actually. There certainly is a lot for a mountain lion to eat. Yeah. My friend Terrible Jack, when I moved to Marlboro 10 years ago, I would see moose tracks every time I went out in the woods, and that is no longer the case. I very seldom see moose tracks, and I'm attributing this to climate change. There are more white-tailed deer in Marlboro. I'm much more likely to see deer tracks, and deer carry the brain worm that really affects moose, and so they don't play well together. And moose are really adapted to cold and snowy environments, so I think we will not be seeing more moose in our future. Which brings us to the future. And, well, look at what we've done here in Windham County in the present. We've brought back the forest. We're starting to see some of the wildlife that was extirpated. We've got fishers, maybe martens. We've got beavers back. White-tailed deer. Is it time to just say, hooray, we can rest on our laurels, the future is looking pretty good? Probably not, and this is where I wish I was Roger and just talking about rocks, because we know they're going to be there in the future. However, for the first time in a century, the percentage of forest cover in Vermont is beginning to decline, and it's largely a result of development, according to the Natural Resources Conservation Service developed land in Vermont has increased from 180,000 acres in 1982 to 302,000, a significant increase of 67% over three decades, outpacing population growth. So that's a concern. Here's our friend Dummerston, just showing the impact that our housing and infrastructure and roads have on wildlife. The deep, dark green areas are the places where area-sensitive animals like moose and bear can feel secure. And also, you know, this is another impact that our homes and houses have. Just think about the number of small carnivores that we have. There are, say, conservatively 200,000 to 300,000 cats and dogs in Vermont, and far fewer foxes and fishers and mesocarnivores, maybe 5,000 in Vermont, just a very rough calculation. So the impact that cats have in particular on the food that's available for other carnivores is significant, not to mention the impact they have on particular creatures like this little bunny. So that's just one of the many influences that our human settlement on the land has. This is a map from the Windham Regional Commission land-based forest landscape report, just showing those big green intact forest fragments that provide really a breeding source habitat for animals like fisher and bobcat and bear. The rest of the yellow is rural residential. The orange is the unforested, and the yellow is the forested. So there's still quite a bit of forest. But let's take a closer look at our friend the bear here. Bears really need a lot of territory. They feed on different things in different seasons. In the spring, they need to travel to wetlands. In the summer, they eat a lot of things, plants mostly, like Jack in the Pulpit. Very big on Jack in the Pulpit. But most essentially in the winter, they have got to feed and get fat on things like beech nuts. So they enter this phase called hyperphagia, where they eat 24 hours a day, just nonstop. So the caloric equivalent, if they're lucky, of, imagine, 16 pints of Ben and Jerry's. And that's absolutely essential. And really, to feed in that way, they need to be half a mile from human settlement in beech and oak mast stands to put on the fat that the females need, especially to successfully reproduce and raise cubs. And roads are another influence. We got to go all the way back through all these pints of Ben and Jerry's. Roads. There we go. Up, down, which way do I go? All right, let's see. Bears, in particular, are loath to cross busy roads and will often use roads as a boundary for their home range and territory. And roads also have a devastating impact on things like frogs and turtles and amphibians, all these other things that we're sort of neglecting in my focus on mammals. This is another map from that forest-based stewardship report showing places where the forest is actively declining, and I see my road on there, and you see your road on there. But I think if we lose those big green places, if they become fragmented by roads and housing development, we lose things like moose, bears. These are the things that you don't find in areas that have fragmentation. Otters, fishers, bobcat. And I just emphasize that if you see these animals in places that are highly fragmented, it's probably because they're moving from these large source populations out into the less ideal habitat. And once you lose the sources, you we lose these species for the whole county. So it's very important for Windham County that we keep those big blocks of green forest. So as fragmentation increases, if we get more of that rural residential settlement, we might also lose some of these guys, the forest bats, the northern flying squirrels, the jumping mice, the really forest-affiliated creatures. Beavers, partly just because they don't mind living right next to people. It's people don't mind living right next to beavers. Yeah, porcupines, kind of the same thing. And these guys are the guys that are going to persist regardless of how fragmented it gets. These are the species that you'll find far south of here and in very suburbanized areas. So, you know, we'll have some good company. The Windham population, since 2008, in the Great Recession, the increase has slowed down, but this is not something we can count on. And I'm a little alarmed by talk I hear about people wanting to encourage population growth in Vermont. And it's... I refer you to this report, Forests on the Edge, Housing Development on America's Private Forests, that shows our area, Connecticut River Valley, projected for high change in forest use from forested to housing. So that's another place where we shouldn't be too relaxed, and remember that for every... number of people that arrive in, there's a ripple effect. There's a demand for more services and infrastructure, and as there's more commerce, we bring in more people, and it's, you know, it's just difficult to put the brakes on and stop when we say, okay, this is enough, this is perfect, this is just how we want it. So just a reminder that there is that ripple effect, and we need to be thinking very carefully and planning very carefully. And onto invasives, our forests are changing because of these guys, emerald ash borer, Asian longhorn beetle, white nose syndrome, wiping out the bats. And I'm flying through this to get to the most important thing, which is my friend here, a burdock, who has emerged from his den on a very cold day last winter to kick off the topic of climate change that... absolutely cannot be ignored. Burdock says it's very, very cold on this day. It was below zero. See all that nice hoarfrost on his head? He says, yeah, a little warmer would be good by me, but it's not Burdock's job to talk about the climate. It's our job to talk about the climate and think about it. So 25 years ago, the science was in, and we started having international meetings to formulate treaties, and yes, 25 years, we can do this. We can get the climate under control, and here we are 25 years later, and then the net result of all of these meetings on climate change is a 60% net increase in global climate emissions. So what does this mean here in New England? Between 1970 and 2000, the rate of temperature increase has grown rapidly. This little graphic just shows the projected number of days above 90 degrees given lower emissions. So scenario B1 there is pretty much locked in. Higher emissions, if we don't get our act together and bring emissions under control. Here in the Connecticut Valley, we're looking at 15 to 20 days above 90 degrees a year, and there is no date on that, but we can assume that that's in someone's future here in Windham County. And here are the beavers also saying we wouldn't mind it being a little bit warmer. However, in 2009, the U.S. and China signed a non-binding agreement to keep climate change below 2 degrees centigrade. That was their goal, and you'll hear that number bandied around quite a bit as something we can live with, you know, 2 degrees climate change. However, that really still spells doom to low-lying island nations and sub-Saharan Africa, and 2 degrees could create a lot of problems. Right now here in New England, we've got 0.8 of a degree of warming Celsius already, and we've got Hurricane Irene and more frequent storm events, more precipitation, longer growing season in the summer, less snow cover in the winter. It just becomes very complicated to figure out what's going to happen. The World Bank, of all organizations, figures that we're en route right now for 4 degrees of warming by the end of this century. 4 degrees of warming would bring extreme heat, declining global food stocks, loss of ecosystems and biodiversity, life-threatening sea level rise, and really no certainty that we can adapt to 4 degrees centigrade rise in temperature. According to Kevin Anderson of the Tyndall Center for Climate Research, a rise of 4 degrees is incompatible with any reasonable characterization of an organized, equitable, and civilized global community, which is sobering. Also sobering, the International Energy Agency put out a report in 2011 saying that we're on course right now for a 6 degree raise in temperature, and they gave the year 2017, that's today, as the year by which, if we haven't reduced our emissions, this is the year that we have created enough infrastructure, fossil fuel infrastructure, to lock in that 2 degrees of warming. And anything beyond this point is going to take us beyond that 2 degrees. So essentially, if we want to stay within 2 degrees, anything that's built after this year has got to be carbon neutral, or we're soaring above 2 degrees, which is, you know, by their calculation. And there are many calculations, but so far, the models that have been developed, we are riding on the trajectory of warmer and faster. So I think that needs to be taken very seriously. Some things that we can do. Back to these wonderful snowshoe hare tracks for a moment, because I am actually feeling slightly optimistic here in 2017, and I'm slightly optimistic because, as you are all aware, we have just taken a giant step in completely the wrong direction in terms of bringing our fossil fuel emissions under control. The Dakota Access Pipeline and the Keystone XL Pipeline are definitely not going to help, and those are now being fast-tracked. However, it's very exciting to see how many people are energized and active and finally ready to make some changes. And I do feel, you know, how long have we been waiting for this to happen? I think this could be the moment. So 2017, it really could be the time. And the other thing that we can do on a local level is to help create resilience among our natural communities by doing everything we can to protect these large fragments of forest. If you look on this map, you might be able to find your place. So the darkest green places are where we have the most important intact forest. We've got this paler green sneaking up through the towns that could act as connectivity so that animals can move as the climate warms.
Patty, would you identify some locations there?
Yes. I'm interested in this nice light green patch that runs through Halifax and up through Marlborough. Does that sneak over to Hogback there? I'm not sure, but and connects up through Marlborough into Newfane, and and via Newfane over to the Green Mountain National Forest, which is what we need, but also up into this great chunk in Windham and Grafton that's wonderfully wild and has been identified as the Nature Conservancy as a matrix block. So very important. And if you look even in your towns here, Dummerston, Light Green, Putney Mountain block here, north, south, and we want to keep a lot of those lower elevation areas also protected because they have completely different species mix from the spruce fir high elevation Green Mountains. So that's another thing that we can work on in the long term, but really in 2017 we've got some very important stuff to do. So unfortunately, with the climate change that's locked in already, we're just going to lose these guys. The moose is already overlapping with the deer, and they really need the cold. Snowshoe hare, same thing. We're not going to have lynx in Windham County, and we're not going to have pine martens in Windham County eventually. And this is just, Naomi Klein has written a great book called This Changes Everything, Capitalism Versus the Climate. And if you haven't read it, I recommend it. And here's just one quote from the book that I want to share with you at the end here. Climate change isn't an issue to add to the list of things to worry about. Next to health care and taxes, it is a civilizational wake-up call, a powerful message spoken in the language of fires, floods, droughts, and extinctions, telling us that we need an entirely new economic model and a new way of sharing the planet, telling us we need to evolve. No time to lose. And so all of these creatures that share this landscape, their living legacy, these guys are the survivors. They have survived all of this. They survived the Pleistocene megafaunal extinction. Will they survive this next one? I'm not sure, but they're precious to us because they're part of the living system that maintains all of life on Earth. They're precious to us as a source of joy and wonder, and I'm just hoping that all of us will find that joy and wonder as a source of inspiration for the very important work that remains ahead as we move into the future.